Please.
Thank you. So I forget to introduce myself. I'm Lilith Farsian, a PhD student of Russian Armenian University, and my main study are concerned with magnetic nanoparticles synthesis and property investigation. And also our today's presentation is related to comparative analysis of chemical and biogenic ferrum-304 nanoparticles and understanding their biocompatibility and toxicity. So during the last decades, there were lots of changes in the health industry, and if we have the cardiovascular diseases as the main cause of death in most of countries, today the situation is changed, and the most deaths according to the WHO report are caused by the antimicrobial resistant infections, and in the second place is the cancer diseases. The modern technologies and the modern drugs that we have are not able to fight against these questions. So that's why our wide investigation cycle is continuously developing for finding new approaches for elimination or maybe treatment and diagnosis method for these diseases. And one of these approaches is the nanobiotechnology, which is related for getting the new methods for diagnosing and treatment methodologies, or so-called theranostics, in these disciplines. And mainly it's investigating the green biotechnology methods, which will have which we will see in our slides. So because the drugs that are mainly used in cancer treatment are have a great toxicity on different on different systems, that's why we are trying to find like not we but the scientists from all over the world are trying to find the new approaches that can improve the treatment methods. And also we know that one of the most important diseases can be reached by the bio nanotechnology field. And of course there are several requirements need to be different drugs. It's a low therapeutic and also I was talking about our offers regarding the target delivery, prevention of drug resistance progress, and achieving a therapeutic result in a shorter period, and all is this combined in the nanoparticles approach that we can use. So what is the green biosynthesis approach? It's the usage of fungi, plants, yeast, and other preliminary products with the combination of different metal salts. So in this case, we use the iron salts mixture for achieving the nanoparticles of with controllable behavior and with low toxic effects. So why the green biosynthesis approach is so effective? Because it's eco-friendly. It doesn't need some special. Also, the green, as I said, it's eco-friendly approach, and one of the main reasons why it's preferable in comparison with chemical and physical methods of synthesis is the coating that we are having with the use of green method. Unfortunately, during the chemical or physical synthesis are used some substances that can prevent the oxidation of the nanoparticles, which usually they have some toxic effects on different models. But by using the plants as our source, the coating which is formed on the shell of the particles is eco-friendly, so it doesn't have any toxic effects as we can see in our results. That's why this is the main approach why we prefer to use the green biotechnology methods. So let's proceed to the results that we have. We have the preliminary study of different endemic plants that have a high anti-radical activity. This is important for carrying the synthesis, and one of the most prominent candidates for this synthesis were the basil leaves, and we investigated both the dry and the fresh leaves and find out that they're a perfect candidates for carrying the green synthesis. You can see the, our results. This is the process of achieving the green particles, and this is the stem image that indicates that we have the nanoparticles that depend to ferrum 304 cluster. And we have tested this this is the chemical synthesis also which we carried out, and on the right part, you can see the transmission microscopy image that indicates that they are nano-sized and also depend to ferrum 304 cluster and have the core shell structure. So nanoparticle size distribution varies for chemical and biological ones. We have the size distribution from 2 to 70 nanometers with most pronounced 11 nanometers size for biogenic, and from 3 to 22 for chemical nanoparticles. For investigation of the toxicity of nanoparticles were carried out different tests. First of all, the nanoparticles were tested against the growth of gram-positive and gram-negative bacteria. For Staphylococcus aureus, we have these results. We have that none of the nanoparticles that were investigated, that was particles synthesized using the basil extracts like aqueous and ethanolic extracts, and none of them showed any antibacterial activity against aureus strain, besides the fact that this stabilizer, which is 96% ethanolic extract of basil or ostimum basilicum, showed antibacterial properties against Staphylococcus aureus. And we don't have any antibacterial effect against Escherichia coli strain, nor for the extracts and nor for the particles. So then we had tested the growth of E. coli bacteria as a function of nanoparticles concentration. Different concentrations were investigated, starting from 50 micromoles to 150 micromoles of maximum dosage. And our investigation showed that there are no any effects on the prolongation of the log phase or any other phase of or the exponential growth of the bacteria. And what was interesting when we compared the same concentrations for chemical and biogenic synthesized nanoparticles, they repeat the behavior and show the same growth curve in the same concentration. So you can see that we have the 150 micromoles of concentration on E. coli during 24 hours, it just shown the first 6 hours. City against human erythrocyte, and the results reveal that properties against the erythrocyte by 100%, both for chemical and biogenic nanoparticles. And here are not shown the results, but these tests also were carried for the cow's cultures on the model of Linium austriacum, and we also don't see any pronounced cytotoxic effects on those. So from the above given results, we can conclude that both the chemical and biogenic nanoparticles are non-toxic for gram-positive and gram-negative bacterial strains. They are non-toxic for erythrocyte, and they don't show any toxic properties also for callus cultures. And as I mentioned in the beginning of our presentation, now we are testing on the different cell cultures, the cytotoxicity properties. So in the last few years, we have developed numerous methods for green synthesis with working with various metal salts, and also we're developed the methods for nanoparticle stabilization. We have several collaborations, both for the local laboratories and for foreign laboratories, and we are open to any collaborations, so we will be happy to collaborate with like wide range of laboratories. And also, this is our laboratory staff. The head is Professor Hovanisyan, and PhD students and students which are involved in this research project. And also, this is our recent publication list. And we are working on there much more, just a small screenshot. And I will be happy to answer any of your questions if there are. So thank you.
Thank you very much for your very interesting presentation.
Let me introduce myself. My name is Alexey Mishalkin. I am a scientific researcher of the Institute of Applied Physics. And today I will speak about the direct surface patterning using carbazole beads as a polymer. The work was done in the framework of the joint bilateral project between Ukraine and Moldova. So he presented our organizations. It is Institute of Applied Physics and Lashkarev Institute of Semiconductor Physics from the Kyiv, Ukraine. So today I would like to tell you about the application of carbazole containing azopolymer materials as recording media for the surface relief formation. Carbazole containing polymer materials and its photoinduced properties studied by our group for a long time. So it was shown that the holographic grating could be obtained in the carbazole materials that involve the exposure of the light, interference on the light. And during the holographic recording, several gratings formed simultaneously. First of all, it is the phase grating due to the modulation of the refractive index of the material. The second is the amplitude grating resulting from the change of the absorption coefficient. And the third type of the grating, it is surface relief grating. It's due to the modulation of the surface relief, and usually it is obtained by the selective etching of the materials. Usually it is done by the wet chemical etching, but in our case, azopolymer materials give us a chance to formation to form the surface relief pattern using the light intensity during the holographic recording without any selective etching. So he has presented the molecule of azo dye. It is a basic molecule. It is like a carbazole molecule. So during the light exposure, it can transform from the trans form to the cis form, and by heat or another wavelength of the light, it can be transformed into the initial state. So Kim and his group was first group that reporting the surface relief grating formation during the elimination of the material. The rehabilitation of the azobenzene group induces the large-scale molecular motions and results in the mass transport of the irradiated azopolymers in films. So he has presented the schematic induced surface relief formation during the exposure of the interfering laser beams. The some motions of azomolecules are performed, and that leads to the formation of the surface relief. And it should be noted that it is not the laser ablation where the material is evaporated. It is just a photoduced mass transport effect. So it was discovered in 1995. And just up to now, the many materials are investigated in order to obtain the high selective, high sensitive materials for the surface relief grating formation. So he has presented the scheme of our material. We used epoxy propyl carbazole as monomer, and we used dispersed orange 3 byte from the Sigma Aldrich, is commercial available as a dye. And by the chemical polymerization of our monomer and our azo dye, we obtained the copolymer epoxy propyl carbazole with dispersed orange 3. The ratio of polymer and azo dye was 90:10. So we have measured the infrared spectra of these materials in order to obtain some absorption bands due to the characteristic groups of these materials. We have confirmed that there are an group, azopolymer group, that it is present in the our azopolymer. It is not seen in the poor polymer composition. And he has presented the attribution of absorption bands due to the different bonds of the our polymer. So here is presented the our stretch bond, nitrogen bond. So the next step was the obtaining of thin films. The thin films was obtained by the spin coating of the solution of our azopolymer. The polymer thin films were prepared by spin coating of the filtered polymer solution onto the glass substrate. First of all, it was put onto the glass substrate, and then by rotating, the solution was evaporated and thin film was obtained. After that, it was dried in oven at 60 degrees for 6 hours. And the thickness of the final film was varied from 200 nanometers up to 2000 nanometers. So he has presented the spectra, absorption, transmittance spectra of our polymer films. The set is the substrate. The second curve is the poor polymer films. You can see the interference in the transmittance spectra due to the high quality transparency and the high quality surface of the our polymer films. And the orange curve is a spectra of our azopolymer thin films. We can see that it has a large absorption band in the range of 400 up to 580 nanometers. And we used the wavelengths of 532 nanometers. It is the wavelength of our recording laser beam, and it is in the absorption band of the azopolymer thin films. And we used the red laser beam in the transmittance region of the polymer material. We used this wavelength for the recording and reading the diffraction efficiency during the holographic recording. So it is it has no absorption in the our polymer films. So here is presented the setup of holographic recording. We used DPSS laser beam at 532 and 473 nanometers. We used beam splitter to divide our laser beam into two beams. And our sample was put into the interference zone of two beams. The period of the interfering grating is according to this formula. It's depend on the wavelength of the laser beam and the angle of two beams that are collimated. So using the red laser beam at 650 nanometers, we used to the controlling the diffraction efficiency growth during the holographic recording. So the higher diffraction efficiency implies the larger surface relief modulation. So recording, so the reading the diffraction efficiency at red laser beam, we can charge, we can judge if the surface relief formation is performed during the holographic recording. So we used several polarization configuration of our recording recording setup. One of these, it is the parallel linear polarization SS. It's vertical linear polarization. The another type of polarization configuration is the linear polarization of recording beams under the angle of plus 45 degree and minus 45 degree. And the last one, it is a secular polarization of recording beams. It is right secular polarization and left secular polarization. And he's presented the resulting electric field vector pattern in the interference fringe. We can see that the using the linear polarization, linear vertical polarization in the interference pattern, we have no change of the polarization. Only the intensity of interference pattern. And the contrast of this intensity is about 100%. But using the another configuration of laser polarization, we have a little contrast of the interference pattern, but the resulting electric field, the polarization in the interference pattern are changing from the linear polarization horizontal linear polarization up to vertical linear polarization, and in the case of plus minus 45 degree, we have a secular polarization in the interference pattern. So, in case of two last cases, we have no light intensity interference pattern on the surface, but the polarization direction changes periodically. Yeah. From horizontal to vertical positions. So here is presented the light intensity distribution in the interference pattern. You can see that for the linear polarization, it has the maximum of intensity modulation up to the two more times intensity.
Hello, I'm sorry. Igor Agaki, please interrupt your microphone.
Mm-hmm. So in case of another polarization, we have a small modulation of intensity in the interference pattern. So he has presented the modulation of diffraction efficiency in dependence on the recording time at different states of the recording beam polarization. First of all, for the secular linear polarization, it has the maximum diffraction efficiency up to 3.5 degree of diffraction efficiency. The second one is the diffraction efficiency for the plus minus 45 degree. It's up to 1.5% of diffraction efficiency. And the diffraction efficiency for the linear vertical polarization S and S, we have no growth of diffraction efficiency. So we can say that using the maximum intensity modulation in the interference pattern lead to no surface relief formation. But using the modulation of polarization states of the interference pattern leads to the formation of the surface relief grating formation with the highest surface modulation. So he has presented the atomic force microscopy results of our grating obtained during the holographic recording. So he has presented the grating obtained by the on the film with a thickness of 217 nanometers. And the height of our profile was obtained up to 80 nanometers. So the ratio of surface relief grating amplitude to the thickness is about 30 degrees of the film thickness. It was obtained for the cases of plus 45, minus 45 degree of configuration of laser beams. And the second slide is the atomic force microscopy images of the grating obtained using the left and light, left, right and left circular polarization of recording beams. Here we obtained the surface modulation up to 130 nanometers, that it is about 48% of the film thickness. It's the highest highest modulation of the surface of the other our polymer films. So we have performed the obtaining of aluminum coating of the grating using the thermal evaporation. So he has presented the atomic force microscopy images of the grating after the aluminum evaporation. We see that it was not destroyed by the thermal evaporation, and the height of our surface relief grating remains the same value of about 130 nanometers. So another type of work was the obtaining of azote polymer composition with magnetic particles. We use iron sulfide magnetic particles. So we studied the holographic recording of this material, of this composition material. So we obtained after the holographic recording both the surface relief grating. It is shown on the left images. The relief profile is close to the sinusoidal one. And on the right side is presented the atomic force image of surface relief overlapped by the magnetic force microscopy map. It is a color map. And it was shown the distribution and value of magnetic field correlates with the period of the grating surface relief that can be used for the creation of surface relief optical elements with unique properties for photonics and in magnetic memory applications. For some conclusions, we report the observation of holographic surface relief grating formation on epoxy propyl carbazole dispersed orange copolymer films without any subsequent processing steps. We also found that polarization configuration like right and left secular polarization is the best case that allows us to achieve the surface relief grating with the largest amplitude, about 130 nanometers, that it is about 50% of the film thickness. On the other hand, the linear polarization configuration SS providing the 100% of intensity modulation doesn't lead to the any grating formation. So we conclude that formation of surface relief grating depends strongly on the polarization distribution. And we have shown that the possibility of direct one-step magnetic relief formation during holographic recording with magnetic particles can be used for creation of surface relief optical elements with properties for photonics and magnetic memory application. So I want to acknowledge the project that was supported our work. It is a Security R2EI project. And the bilateral project Ukraine-Moldovian that we done the last years and thank you for your attention and for your comments and any questions. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you, the presenter. So if there are any questions, we are opening 2 minutes for question answer section. Okay, so in this case, I will try to have to ask a question if you are ready. So and it is very interesting to make this optical relief on polymers, but there is an interesting, you know, question about how this pattern is changing over the time, or it because it is polymer, so we can expect an core arranging of molecules during the time. Have you investigated the durability of this surface relief?
Yes. We have studied the storage of this obtained surface relief grating up to under the room temperature. It was stable up to 1 year of storage, but in the case of higher temperature, up to 40 degrees, the polymer is fluent and the grating is erased. And no surface relief is obtained during the high temperature.
Okay.
My theme is the implementation of mesh network based on nanosensors. I'm from Technical University of Moldova. So the general concept was to build some kind of device which be enabled to integrate into some kind of infrastructure-less network to have a good coverage of sensing nodes or sensing levels to make monitoring over the area. Of course, we are not trying to monitor some great areas, because if you build a wireless network, there is always a limit of nodes you may integrate into it. But we are planning at least to have the higher limit of some kind of 10 of 100 of thousands. Now we gained the level of thousands, just thousands, but theoretically, there will be no problem to add some new devices. So I think we will gain this kind of networks even more developed. Why we are going to do this? What's the general point? Of course, as I said, the big advantage of some this kind of network is to have the infrastructure-less property, which means we don't need any access points, we don't need any GSM coverage or our coverage of existing networks. We want, and we already have the possibility to add new nodes without additional configuration. The big thing which I'm going to talk additionally is to make a node autonomous, which means that we don't want to access this node periodically to make some kind of maintenance or charging or changing of some parts, for example, batteries. We really don't want to do that. That's why we are going and we integrated the solar panels to make these nodes work by themselves totally. And one thing which is great for these networks, we may create some kind of heterogeneous network, which means that every node may be different in his kind. For example, one node may measure one type of gas, another node may measure humidity or temperature, and so on. Every node may be configured and created to build to measure something more specific. Of course, we cannot create totally different nodes. They should at least support the common communication protocol. But this is some simple, obvious thing, which it is inevitable. Also, the parameters which are measured are different, and they can be even more different. The architecture of one single node is an obvious one. There is nothing very complicated because we want to keep it autonomous, which means it should be simple. We have a sensing module, sensing element. In our case, it's based on oxide materials which are based on some nanostructures. We have a module which support communication with neighbors, power module which support charge, discharge, monitoring, and some additional configurations to control the power source, and a general module which controls, diagnose, make some additional calculations for all this architecture. We are trying to add some additional interventions in the traditional measuring technique. The general concept to measure the response of sensor, which is used until now and will be used, of course, in future, is to measure the resistive response of the sensing element. And this is not quite simple if you want to create a universal device which support different sensing types, different sensing materials, because they have really different proper resistance and really different response. This is the first problem. And the second problem is that a lot of materials don't really get good response at the temperature level, ambient temperature. That's why we usually integrate those sensing elements into some micro heaters or some element which heat the sensing element. And all these kinds of additional electronical components consume energy as well, and we should keep that in mind. That's why we moved a little bit in our direction and try to measure not the resistive response, but the capacitive one. And here we minimize the consumption, not using the heater. Actually, we still use it, but I think we will move through the totally heatless configuration. And those we raise the operating time of this device up to 400-500%. Of course, there is no silver bullet, and removing the heater, we create the problems which this heater resolved. The selectiveness became worse. So if we need the real selective sensor, we have or to think some kind of improvements or to add some heating source. And usually without the heat, the sensor response is lower. But actually, if sensor is capacitive based, the response is good enough. Yes, it's not the same level as being resistance, but it's okay to measure that those level. It's usable. So going with direction and trying to integrate this into some kind of network, we add communication module, which now is a Bluetooth one with Bluetooth mesh protocol. As I said, theoretically, it supports like tens of thousands of nodes. Of course, we didn't test it because it's a large number, but I believe in these measures since they are logical ones. There is the problem since the Bluetooth is a broadcast-based network, which means that within the network will be a lot of additional traffic, which is not quite useful, but it should be because the mesh network is the unstable one. The general concept of this kind of network is that node may be online, may be offline. It may be periodically started, paused, stopped. So the mesh network is a very dynamic thing. So that's why it should be broadcast based. It should be accessible by itself. Yes, and the third problem, the third important module which was implemented, tested, it's a module of power control and power calculation based on the solar element. Since we are trying to keep the network nodes autonomous, it should power himself in the autonomous mode. And here are some experiment testing how the module is charging and discharging. This experiment shown here are with the heaters, which they are not quite relevant to the capacitive-based sensors, but soon I think we will have some results for the capacitive too. The image we have here, if we will calculate for how long one node may work with a simple solar cell, simple battery, and the heat resistive base sensor, it will mean that it should be started like once in 2 or 3 hours and sleep like 3 hours. Started will work some several seconds and sleep again for like 3 hours. So if we don't hurrying and monitoring, usually it's okay to measure the gas level once at three hours, but if we need the really, really fast response, if we want to see the actual image of the environment, this period is not quite good. Additionally, we have developed a simple algorithm to monitor the charge, the remaining charge in the battery, in order to even measure the period. So if the battery is not charged, maybe it's almost empty, we are not running the node too often, so the period always is increasing if the battery is discharged. So basically the node is waiting for some light source in order to charge this battery, and then the period will be higher again. And as a result, we see some good combinations, some good approach to make the device, of course, capacitive base without heater, without this dairy consuming element, with some integrated algorithms of frequency period calculation for the next measurement. And also, we just started, it is not here in presentation. Also, we are implementing some additional protocol, which will take into account the charge level, because the communication module is a consuming one as well. I didn't mention it, but the antenna, the communication is a consuming element, one of the most consuming elements of the device. So the next good improvement is going to be some algorithm which will take into account which device is more charged, and then the communication will move through those more charged devices. So this is the idea of the power devices. So I want to help to thank you for the audience, of course, for the Nanotech Nanosensor Research Center, where this work is done and keep being developed, to the Moxas project, which helped us to create some this kind of devices, and of course to the organizers for this beautiful conference. So I'm ready for your questions if you have any. Thank you.
Thank you very much for your presentation.
We studied magnetic, superconductive, and quantum oscillations property of hybrid bismuth antimony structures. Sampling for measurement consists of bulk single crystalline disoriented blocks, crystallite, and one or more nanoids interfaces with a pronounced degree of imperfections. The interfaces was of a solitary central layer, about 60 nanometers, and two similar adjacent, about 20 nanometer layers. Figure 2 present temperature and field dependencies of magnetic moment of our structure, highlighting a single or two superconducting transition. The temperature dependencies of magnetic moment are characterized by increase of the difference between the zero field pulled and field pulled signal followed by magnetic field expulsion. The supercritical field in our structures take value corresponding to the zero temperature coherence length about 30 nanometers and the superconducting layer thickness of about 100 nanometers. They exceed the respective value for the bicrystal interfaces with two superconducting transitions. As a result, interaction of Cooper electrons with structural imperfections, the superconducting critical temperature of central layer decrease to value of the adjacent layers. Typical magnetic hysteresis loop of bismuth antimony hybrid structures are given in figure 2b. Three distinct types of magnetic loops are clearly highlighted. Loops as those of type 2 superconductors, large crystalline disorientation angled bicrystal and more complex structure with a pronounced degree of imperfection exhibit superconductivity and ferromagnetism hysteresis loops. At the same time, a number of the bicrystal with a high content of imperfections and two superconducting transition exhibit the dual superimposed ferromagnetic and superconducting loops, which indicates the simultaneously coexistence of superconductivity and weak ferromagnetism at interfaces. Figure 3 show an example of the quantum oscillations of magnetoresistance and thermomagnetic power in our bismuth antimony structures. One frequency of quantum oscillations corresponding to the Fermi surfaces of the crystallites, and two frequencies associated with the Fermi surface of the interfaces layers were detected. It was found that the hybrid structures with pronounced degree of imperfection develop frequencies of the quantum oscillations taking different value for central and adjacent layers. And also crystallite of hybrid structure. The ratio of frequency in the structures with more interfaces is lower than that in the structure with one interface. This fact reflects firstly a higher deformation of the carrier isoenergetic surfaces, and secondly, a high defect concentration carrying an uncompensated charge. It has been also found that the cyclotron masses of Dirac electron and density of state in interfaces layer significantly exceed the respective value for crystallite. That is, the Dirac carrier and interface layers are much heavier than those in the bulk crystallite, which imply more diversity in the evolution of superconductivity and hypermagnetism. Thank you for attention.